I haven't been this beat up since my Aunt Fifi's bridal shower.
Well, I'd say this story's off to a good start. And I'm gonna guess that it's only gonna get crazier from here. This is 2015's hashtag lucky number. What would you do if you had access to a celebrity's phone? Spoiler alert, while I may give you my opinion on the film, that's no substitute for watching it yourself. Links to the film are in the description. Brett tries to convince his friends, G and Paz, that everything will get better, but they aren't listening. Soon, we see that it's actually the Saint's phone, and he's been parading around with his old phone number while trying to be him to live out his life. I couldn't imagine that going any way but great. When we go back to the beginning, we see Brett bringing home his belongings from work, and we can only assume that he's been fired. When he goes inside his apartment, he finds out that his girlfriend has a bunch of other guys over, and they're engaging in some fun adult time. One guy even gets a little upset because he thinks Brett is trying to cut in line. That's gotta be one of the worst ways to find out that your girl's cheating on you. 2 weeks later, Brett has some of his friends come over to help him pack up his apartment, and they tell him that he's got a bad case of the stink. A woman even looks like she's about to physically vomit after looking at him. After they go play ball for a bit, they notice that Brett is still getting messages and calls from Jules. G actually goes through his phone, and he finds out that Jules is sending pictures of herself doing unspeakable acts with other men. Brett moves in with his mother, and they sit and watch the game that night. As the Saint scores a buzzer beater, they lose their mind in the living room. Brett admits that the Saint is his childhood idol, and he's more than jealous of the lifestyle he lives. Even his own mother talks about how he needs to get the stink off of him, and his first step is to look good enough to get laid. How many people have a mom like that? She rips up his phone and tells him to go get a new phone and number. Meanwhile, the Saint shows off his real side when he talks about how he wants to tap the boss's daughter, Nikki Page. At the same time, the Saint's girlfriend, Gianna, comes in, and she has a face that could kill. You just know that she knows something. That night, Gianna confronts the Saint about numerous calls and texts from random girls that are trying to hook up, and she breaks his phone so he has to get a new phone and number. The next day, Brett and the Saint are both getting new numbers, and the Saint's assistant, Scar, tells him that his phone is now untraceable. After that, Brett goes around and interviews for a new job, and he notices that he starts to get cryptic messages from random hotspot locations. Brett starts to take advantage of the perks of the new number. That seems like a reasonable way to take advantage of some new power, and it actually works out in his favor, because he ends up getting Nikki Page's number. How many people in the world can say that they just got their dream girl's phone number that easily? Later that night, Brett gets a few messages that let him know that he's got the Saint's old number, and he thinks that he should give up the phone before he gets himself in deep trouble. G and Paz, of course, tell him that he shouldn't even think about it. They talk him into indulging in some of the free things that are offered, and he sets down a few ground rules. Only take what's coming, never mention the Saint by name, and don't steal anything. After taking some free things, he ends up texting Nikki on the phone and asks if she wants to go out the next day. When Nikki comes over to the Saint's house the next day for a charity event, he tries to exchange numbers with her, but she respectfully declines. When Brett takes Nikki out for dinner, he finds out that she actually hates fancy restaurants. But not before he makes the restaurant owner furious with the Saint. When they end up leaving the restaurant, they head to the park where they get a good old-fashioned hot dog. Towards the end of the night, he has the perfect moment to come clean about everything, but do you think he told her? You all know better than that. This would have been a short film instead of a feature film. When the night comes to a close, she gives him the option to come up, but he refuses. She ends up loving that answer, but she rewards him with a genuine kiss. The next day, Nikki calls Brett, and she mentions that she has a sportscaster friend that'll be going to a lingerie show. Sportscasting is Brett's dream job, but he assures her that he has his own hookup to the show. During the entire conversation, Brett's mother is next to him, and the more she talks, the more Nikki starts to question things. Brett assures her that she's just a maid, and he'll see her that night. That night, the Saint doesn't perform during the game, and Brett's friends wonder if he at least scored the night before. When he tells them that it didn't feel right, they take it about as well as a lot of guys do. But then Brett mentions that he needs to find money before Nikki realizes that he's all talk and nothing more. Of course not! Stop digging yourself deeper into this hole! Later, they gain access to the lingerie show, and they don't know that the Saint is there already too. As they network and work their magic for their own gain, Scar's plan to get the Saint laid is going into motion. But people only have the Saint's old number. So when the text goes through that the Saint is supposed to meet in a room in the basement to have some fun, Brett ends up getting the text. What happened here? None of this was what I was expecting when I started the film. If you had told me I would have seen Method Man wearing a clown nose while being whipped, I would have laughed so hard. When Brett makes it back to the bar, he gets G and Paz to run, and the Saint gets Scar and the Bouncer to rally and chase after them. After the guys make it away, Scar notices that Brett has the Saint's old number. The next morning, the guys think that it's finally time to hang up the phone gigs. But Brett actually doesn't think he should give up when he's so close to everything he's ever wanted. Meanwhile, Scar and the Saint try to come up with a plan for how to handle Brett. Then the next night, the Saint has a terrible performance during the game, and he actually ends up getting pulled out of the game. Brett and Nikki watch from the penthouse suite, and we find out that Nikki's charity might be in trouble if the Saint can't get it together. That same night, Nikki helps Brett get rid of the stink, and the next morning, the Saint developed his own stink in his relationship. Scar lets him know everything she's found out about Brett, but when he finds out that Brett is dating Nikki, it hits him on a whole different level. You really gotta wonder if he's actually mad about him using the phone number in favors, or if it's more because of him being with Nikki. Meanwhile, Gianna's tanning naked right outside the window. Brett gets a call from the sportscaster he gave his demo reel to, and he finds out that he likes what he saw. After they talk about a meetup to potentially sign him as an anchor for a new sports show, we see that Scar and the Saint have already talked to the sportscaster, and they're setting Brett up to fall when they meet up in the VIP. Brett feels like everything is all sunshine and rainbows, but the Saint can't see anything other than Brett. With one game left in the finals, it comes down to the last game in a few nights. But the Saint doesn't care. He just wants to show Brett how bad he messed up using his number and name. That same night, Nikki overhears the Saint talking about Brett, and she questions how he knows him. The night that Brett goes to meet with the sportscaster, he ends up running into Jules, who's waiting in the line outside. After Brett gets the satisfaction of leaving her outside in the line, he struts across the dance floor with Paz and G until they come up to the VIP area. G tries to confront Brett about how he's becoming a douchebag in the process of becoming a more successful person. Soon, Nikki arrives, and it becomes clear that everyone involved knows what's really been going on. Brett pulls her aside to kind of tell her the truth about everything, but before he can really get too much out, she tells him to check his phone. Sure enough, he has a text from the Saint, and soon, he's standing right behind him. That's where your natural self-defense should kick in. For someone like him to be in a matchup like that, I'd say his best option is to kick and scream until someone comes to escort you out. Shame doesn't come into play when your neck's on the line. After Scar reads the cost of all the things they took for free, Brett tries to assure everyone that everything was offered for free, but the Saint makes sure to remind him that it was offered for free to him. And with that perfect timing that all exes seem to have, Jules shows up just in time to say that Brett is her boyfriend. This woman went from sending pics of her blowing people to claiming him as her boyfriend in no time flat? No thank you.
And that's when my buddies and I got that serious ass whooping.
He can't even complain about it. He literally saw it coming, but at the time, probably thought it was all worth whatever was at the end of the road. As we see them walk down the stairs again, we've officially come full circle. Brett assures everyone that he's going to fix everything, but it looks a little grim. Naturally, Brett tries to ask his mother for advice, but she simply tells him that it's time for him to grow up and figure out his own problem. That night, he passes out in an alley on some trash, and in the morning, he still can't figure out what he really has to do. It's only after talking to the hot dog stand guy that he gets inspiration to figure out what to do. After calling Paz and G, everyone decides to follow Brett's lead. After calling the entire blue-collar worker mafia, they set up an elaborate scheme to delay the Saint from making it in time to screw Nikki. First, the plumber comes out and shuts off the water while he's showering. After he gets out of the shower, the plumber sends the water from the toilet shooting up in his face. Next, the gate man disables the gate. Then they shut down the normal road. After that, the driver takes the long way around and takes his time. They got one quote right for sure. If you want your day screwed up, just call the blue-collar mafia. Have you noticed how all blue-collar workers in an area have contact information for other blue-collar workers? They might only ever meet each other once, but they'll all remember who you are and what you do. Apparently, Brett tricks Jules into meeting up with the Saint in Nikki's place. And when the Saint finds out that he's been having playtime with her instead of Jules, he loses his mind. Brett snaps a picture of him, and he makes his escape. The Saint runs into Nikki in the stairway, and she calls him out for what he was saying while he was thinking he was with her. Little does he know that Nikki was watching the security footage live the whole time. Finally, the Saint gets down to the game floor, and he runs into his wife just as Jules shows up and calls him a pet name. Before Gianna can really say much, the Saint hurries past her to get ready for the game. Meanwhile, Nikki meets her father up in the VIP balcony, and he can tell that something's wrong. She mentions that it's boy problems. and he knows exactly how to help her. I'm sorry, but it's nice to have that random character that's only there for a few moments, but he's got that strong, purely good role. Nikki's father's the perfect father for the situation. He owns the entire team, but he's still never too big to spend personal time to help his daughter when she's having a hard time. Before the game begins, Brett walks out onto the court and begins a public confession by starting out saying that he's a liar. Smooth move, Brett. While the Saint tries to get out on the court to Brett, the blue-collar mafia shows up to make sure that doesn't happen. Brett goes on to show everyone pictures of what Jules was sending him so everyone knew the story from the beginning. Just before he puts up the picture he just took of the Saint, he and the Saint exchange a glance that made him understand that it might not be a good idea. Soon, the Saint gets the police off of Brett and lets him finish his speech. Once he's done, Nikki comes running out on the court, and she kisses him passionately. All in all, Brett ends up getting his dream job, he gets to be with Nikki, and he even drives off with the Bentley that he borrowed earlier on. I'd say that's a win for everyone involved. Hashtag Lucky Number is a solid feel-good movie that does a nice job of using setting and backstory that hasn't really been touched yet. That alone was enough to make it refreshing. Obviously, all the bad choices are still there, but what kind of movie would these be if they didn't follow the tropes? If this is your style of movie, I'd say give it a shot. Thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoyed the video. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more like this one. Comment what you think I should watch next, and I'll see you in the next video.